Ephesians chapter 1. I want to remind you of our special anniversary service we're going to have in October. October, we're going to have a anniversary, and actually we're actually going to be out on the property as well that night on the 20th of October. It's going to be a great time, fellowship. We're going to have our building fund program service, whatever you call it, kingdom investment, where we believe that God is going to multiply what we invest in the kingdom, but we're looking forward to growth and what God has in the future. And so would you just be in prayer that God would reveal everything that we need to see and know, and whatever opportunities he sends our way, that we would be able to know exactly what he wants us to do with them. Can you pray that with us? Amen. Amen. How many of you tomorrow can commit to praying that God would lead us, guide us, direct us? Anybody by show of hands would pray tomorrow that we would pray together as a church? I'm asking that as a church tomorrow we would pray, God, reveal, show, direct. Let's just join together, make tomorrow a prayer of the future, of what God has in store. Amen. For this body. Amen. So we're just going to believe together for that. Praise God. In Ephesians chapter 1, verse 1, Paul, I tell you what, y'all can be seated. Amen. Thank you for standing. You can be seated. Paul, an apostle of Jesus Christ, by the will of God, to the saints which are at Ephesus. What is Paul? An apostle. Why? By the will of God. To who? To the saints. Where? Ephesus. Amen. And to the faithful in Christ Jesus. That's us. Hello. I'll take some of that. Amen. Notice he says that his apostleship is for a purpose. Grace be to you and peace from God our Father and from the Lord Jesus Christ. Blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places in Christ. Amen. So, Sister Sherry, I'm so glad that God filled you with the Holy Ghost. We've had six filled with the Holy Ghost in the last week. Can we just give God the glory for that? Isn't that wonderful? Praise be to God. To God be the glory. Amen. And it says here, blessed be the God and Father of our Lord Jesus Christ, who hath blessed us. Everybody say, blessed us with all spiritual blessings. Everybody say, spiritual blessings. Not natural blessings. There are spiritual blessings. There are spiritual, and it doesn't just say some, it says A-L-L, which is P-A-S in the Greek, pas, which means all. It literally means all. God has blessed us. You know what true blessings are? Amen. It's not your bank account. True blessing is when God blesses you with all spiritual. You can be dead in your sins with a bank account and go to hell. But when you get spiritual blessings, you're going to be seated in heavenly places in Christ. There's a blessing that's greater than natural. We can pursue the wrong blessings if we're not careful. Because the true blessings are spiritual blessings. He says he has blessed us with all spiritual blessings in heavenly places. Amen. In Christ. Notice that this scripture is teaching us that the spiritual blessing, all the spiritual blessings are in the heavenly places. Everybody say, in Christ. According as he hath chosen us in him. He has chosen us in him. Before the foundation of the world, the scripture says that Christ is from the beginning. He's the beginning of all things. He's the beginning of God's creation. And what does that mean? It means In the beginning was the Word. Everybody say the Word. In the beginning was the Word, and the Word was with God. The Word was God. All things were made by Him. Without Him was not anything made that was made. The Word, what is Christ? He's the Word made flesh. In verse 14 it says, the Word was made flesh and dwelt among us. We beheld His glory, the only begotten of the Father, full of grace and truth. The Father is the Spirit. God is a Spirit. The Spirit of God moved upon the face of the waters. And then God said, the manifestation of the Spirit is the Word. The Spirit didn't become visible till the Word spoke. The Word reveals the heartbeat of the Spirit. The Father is the Spirit, creates all things. The Father, speaking of the Spirit, amen, the begotten Son of God, amen, is Jesus Christ. He's the only begotten Son of God. Amen. He was born of a woman, but He existed from the beginning because He was in the beginning, because He's the Word. God is a Spirit. They that worship Him must worship Him in spirit and in truth. Aren't you thankful that you know who Jesus is? Aren't you thankful that you know who you are in Jesus? Now, this is powerful because all the spiritual blessings are in Christ. And it says that He chose us in Him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and without blame before Him in love. Do you realize that God saw this day before He said, let there be light? Now, He's God. So He kind of knows everything. It's kind of hard to wrap our minds around that. But He chose us in Him before the foundations of the world. God knew you would be saved before you were even born. Can I speak to the church today? I'm preaching to those that are the faithful in Christ Jesus. That's what He said, right? To the faithful in Christ. He has chosen us in Him before the foundation that we should be, everybody say, be holy and without blame before Him in love. Now, these spiritual blessings in heavenly places are found through the power of God in us, and it's through this redemption process of God's removal of our sin that we can be holy and without blame, okay, blameless. There's nothing held against us. Somebody, amen, say, thank God that He took our sins away and that He put a robe of righteousness on us. We're not holy because of us. It's His holiness that's on us. It's the holiness is God removing the things that made us unholy and putting us in a position of separation or service unto Him. So we are holy because of His righteousness, because of His grace, because of His blood. There's a lot of things that make us holy because of our separation, and we're without blame before Him in love. Having predestinated us unto the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to Himself, according to the good pleasure of His will. 100% of this is built on God's desires for us. He chose us. He predestinated us to be a part of this adoption of children. He is going to, through Calvary, which was God's master plan, if you will, His desire to come and sacrifice Himself. If you think about it, God didn't have to do any of this. God didn't have to suffer and die. He didn't have to come in the form of a man. He didn't have to do anything. He didn't even have to create Adam and Eve. Why did He do it? The Scripture teaches us He did it because of love. God wanted to love, and He wanted to reciprocate that love. He wanted somebody that would love Him with no strings attached. He was seeing a bride in His future. I don't know if there's any men here that looked forward to the day that you would have a bride, but I know I dreamed of the day that I would have a bride. Hello, amen. Did you know that there is a shift in our culture today, and men have less manliness than they used to have? kind of sad, but men are becoming less manly. They're becoming less driven to find a lady. Part of it's due to pornography. Part of it's due to the food we're eating. Part of it's due to, well, there's a whole lot of reasons. But part of it's the culture. But I'm going to tell you, amen, that God didn't design men to be less manly. God wants men to be men, and he wants ladies to be ladies. And when you have men and you have ladies get together, you have an awesome combination. You have marriage. You have children that serve God. You have children that glorify God. God didn't create something broken, but when he made marriage, he already saw the church, and he said, I see what the church and what the Christ and the bride is going to look like, so I'm going to make marriage ahead of time to reflect what it's going to look like when I have a church. We are just a type and shadow of the church and the bride of Christ. Amen. Really, it was all about the love that he was going to get from it. What we experience in church is the greatest. Amen. And it's going to happen when we go to heaven. It's going to be the greatest marriage party, reception, celebration. We're going to be with our lover forever. Do you realize, amen, the excitement of your wedding was just a precursor prelude to what's going to happen when Jesus takes his bride out of this world and he marries her for eternity. I'm telling you, we got something to look forward to. Hallelujah. I hope you don't, okay. All right. To the young and to the old in Christ, I got a word for you tonight. If you'll open your spirit, God's going to put revelation inside of you, and he's going to give you, amen, some understanding and some things that's going to take you to another level in your walk with God tonight. I don't care if you've been in church all your life. There's something in this for you today. Amen. And so can you forget about what you're doing tomorrow? Can you forget about what you're doing right now? Can you quit clipping your nails and balancing your looking at your bank account on your iPhone? Amen. I almost said balance your checkbook. I don't even know if anybody does that anymore. Amen. Praise God. Amen. We've been predestinated in the adoption of children by Jesus Christ to himself, according to the good pleasure of his will. It's God's desire that we should become children of God through Christ. What he did to himself, he has purchased us, but he's also adopted us as children to the praise of the glory of his grace, to the praise of his glory. This is why he did it. This adoption process that was predestined from the beginning of creation, it's in the mind of God before we ever got here. God already knew what was going to happen, and he did it because of the good pleasure of his will, that he might receive praise to the praise of the glory of his grace, wherein he hath made us accepted in the beloved. Remember when the voice from heaven spoke, said, this is my beloved son in whom I am well pleased. Hear ye him. That was on the Mount of Transfiguration. When he was baptized, there was a voice that came from heaven. Jesus said, this is for your sakes. God, you know, and then he says, glorify your name. God says, I'm going to glorify it. Amen. There were confirmations and witnesses of his ministry. Well, this is talking about our God being pleased with us and God accepting us as his beloved children. Okay? Oh my goodness. I wish I could get into somebody's head for just a minute and kind of reprogram your thinking. I wish, you know, wouldn't it be nice if you could just get a reprogrammed brain that was like operating at full capacity with the Word of God? You know how you get that? You get in it every day. You'll never have a fully operating biblical operating system at full capacity if you're influenced by the world's agenda and you're not influenced by what the Word of God is speaking. If you're not reading this book, but you're reading every other book that authors are putting out, you're filling your mind with worldly wisdom, and it's 100% flesh-driven. And I'm telling you, the flesh doesn't please God. And I hope you get convicted. Amen. Right now. Amen. Because you will never, ever, amen, exhaust the wisdom of this book, nor will you ever regret any moment you spend developing yourself in this book. You will never wish you had spent time entertaining your flesh once your spirit man receives the food and the nutrition that he needs or she needs. Amen. So don't ever undervalue the value of that word. Amen. Because it's powerful. And he says here, amen, that we are to the praise of his glory. He's made us accept in the blood, in whom we have redemption through his blood. In Christ, we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. It's through the blood of Jesus that we have been redeemed from our sins. Amen. According to the riches of his grace. Now, this is where it gets super powerful, because the riches of his grace, as we're going to see, is the Holy Ghost that's within us. Now, I want to talk to you tonight about what's happening when somebody speaks in tongues for the first time. I want to talk to you tonight about what's actually happening when somebody gets the Holy Ghost. Why do we shout and get excited when six people speak in tongues the very first time? We're not excited that they spoke in tongues. We're not seeking tongues. We're not excited that they made noise with their mouth. That's not what we're after. We're excited that they are now filled with the riches of his glory, seated in heavenly places with Christ Jesus. This is where it gets good. This is where it gets good. Wherein he hath abounded, it says, that according to the riches of his grace, wherein he hath abounded toward us in all wisdom and prudence. There is an abundance of wisdom. There's priceless wealth. There is all wisdom. And the moment they step in to life in the Spirit, they literally access every bit of wisdom that God has. Not some of it. They have unlimited access to all of it. That's like having an unlimited bank account that you can swipe the card anytime you need it. Unlimited, abounded towards us, abounded. That word abounded right there means, guess what? Abound. That's what it means. It means to increase, to be above number or measure. It means to be just overflowing. And he's abounded, everybody say, toward me. I wish we could reprogram our brains right now. Instead of thinking in ways that the enemy has programmed you to think through lies, which tells you you're not enough, you're not good enough, you'll never make it, and you'll never amount to anything. You need to start thinking in God terms. You got enough. In fact, you don't have enough. You got access to more than enough. You have unlimited potential, because your potential's not tied to your shortcoming. It's tied to the glory of his grace that's inside of you. The Holy Ghost unlocks everything God has. And it's not limited. It's unlimited. All wisdom and prudence. Having made known unto us, this is where it gets awesome. He's made known unto us the mystery of his will. Wait a second. God has a mystery that's been hid since the beginning of the ages. And it's his will. And now Paul says, we know what it is. Now, folks, think about it. Abraham didn't know it. Jonah didn't know it. They saw it kind of through. They knew there was something and they were pressing towards it. But they didn't know what the mystery was. Adam didn't know it. Eve didn't know it. Not a person in the Old Testament had the revelation of the mystery. But Paul says he made known to us. What the prophets couldn't see, we have it. What Noah couldn't see, the church has it. the mystery of his will, according to his good pleasure, which he hath purposed in himself. Now, I'm telling you, amen. We could just look at it. In Colossians, amen, chapter 1, verse 26, it says, even the mystery which has been hid from ages, from generations, but now is made manifest to his saints, to whom God would make known what is the riches of the glory of this mystery among the Gentiles, which is Christ in you. Oh, my goodness. Sherry, I don't know your background. I don't even need to know it. I just know one thing. You're a new person. The God that said, let there be light, is inside of you. And you're just as much filled with God as any other person in this room. Amen. It is Christ in you, the hope of glory. We got a hope that's beyond this world, because we're not filled with the spirit of this world. We are filled with God. Christ in you. You mean God can be in me? The moment you get the Holy Ghost with the evidence of speaking in other tongues, you didn't just speak in tongues. God came into you. You became the temple of the Holy Ghost. The Spirit that tore the veil and left the tabernacle in Shiloh lives inside of the body of Christ, and in you in particular. You are the temple of the living God. So glorify God in your body. You are the temple of the Spirit of God. God, the God that said, let there be light. And that's why when you get the Holy Ghost and you open this book and you start reading the letters of this book, it's no longer a dead book with pages that cannot be understood, but it becomes a living, breathing document. You read it and the words come off the page, because the same Spirit that wrote it is inside of you, bringing revelation to what God says. I'm telling you, there is no greater hope in the world than a church that is filled with the Spirit of God. It is the Spirit that brings life. It's the Spirit that creates opportunity. Without it, we're dead. And so Paul says, he says that he's made known to us the mystery of his will in verse 9, according to the good pleasure which he purposed in himself. He made up his mind because of his joy that he was going to reveal it to us. We have this revelation. What's the mystery? You know, and a lot of people would tell you, oh, it's a mystery. No one's ever going to figure it out. Well, I'm going to tell you, the mystery's been made known. It's the Holy Ghost. It's the Spirit. It's what they got on the day of Pentecost. And he has not stopped pouring it out since the day of Pentecost. If you want the Holy Ghost inside of you, if you want to be the temple of living God, you can get it tonight. Amen. And if you need a renewing, the Bible says they prayed and then they were filled again. Amen. You can get it again and again and again. You ought to get it again. You cannot live a day without it. Amen. Paul said, amen, I'm going to pray every single day of my life in the Spirit. It's the will of God to live in the Spirit. Because why? We have access to all of this grace, the riches of his grace. We have access to this infinite wisdom, all wisdom and prudence. We have access to everything God has, that in the dispensation of the fullness of times he might gather together in one all things in Christ, both which are in heaven and which are in earth, even in him. Hallelujah. There's coming a day, amen, when there's going to be things that are restored. There's not going to be any more church disunity. It's going to be one church, one bride, one. We're all going to be in heaven gathered around the throne. You talk about a day. You talk about a day of rejoicing when we all get to heaven. What a day it's going to be. Hallelujah. Oh, God have mercy. Woo. Amen. No more pain. No more tears. No more sorrow. No more work. Amen. In the natural. No more physical things. Amen. To weigh you down. You're going to be a man walking, a woman walking in the Spirit, living in the presence of God, obeying the commands of God, judging angels, ruling cities, doing the will of God. In whom? Christ. Also, we have obtained an inheritance. So not only are we children, Not only are we predestined and by God we've been brought into the mystery of revelation, filled with His Spirit, but we've also been given an inheritance, being predestinated according to the purpose of Him who worketh all things after the counsel of His own will. If you don't have the Spirit, you're never going to understand the counsel of His will. If you don't have the Spirit, you can't operate in the predestined blessing that comes to the people that walk in the Spirit, that live in, that are filled with that Spirit. I'm telling you, doesn't make us better than anybody. It just gives us all the advantage. It doesn't make us one bit better. We're just mud balls saved by grace. But it gives us every advantage that you can have because now God is working in you. God is moving through you. God is doing things after the counsel of His own will. How do you know the counsel of the will of God? You got to get into the inheritance. You got to become a son of God. The purpose of Him, talk about purpose. There's no purpose outside the Spirit leading and guiding. How many of you remember before Holy Ghost? Before Jesus, it was 100% the counsel of our own will. I wish somebody wake up tonight and realize God saved you for a purpose. I said, God saved you for an eternal predestined from the foundation of the world purpose. You're not an accident. I said you're not an accident. You didn't accidentally come into this world. You didn't accidentally, amen, find your way into a house of God. You didn't accidentally, you haven't saved yourself by your will. You haven't filled yourself by your will. There's not a bit of things we can do to take credit. We can't even take credit for being in this room today. Amen. It's only the grace of God, the mercy of God, and according to the purpose of God that we can even have hope today. We got to give glory to God. It was to His glory. It's to the glory of His grace. It's to the God's will is being accomplished even in this moment as we sit here, finding His will in our lives. It's predestined. Okay, why is He talking about all this? Because it would be really easy for us to think we're not worthy. Be really easy for us to condemn ourselves because of our past. But what He's saying is, God erased your past. Now what are you going to be condemned over? God gave you righteousness. Now you're holy and blameless. What have you got to be condemned over? Quit thinking like a beggar and start thinking like a king. Start thinking like a prince that has power with God and will prevail. Hallelujah. We are mighty in Christ. This is the mindset Paul's working from. Okay, you got to understand, he's got a revelation. He's sharing it. That in the dispensations of the fullness of times, He might gather together. I read that. Verse 12. That we should be to the praise of His glory who first trusted in Christ. Isn't that amazing? That we should be. You know why? God wants us to be to the praise of His glory. Every time you see somebody filled with the Holy Ghost, every time you see the work of God in an individual, oh my goodness. Every time you see what they used to be and what they are today, what they were before and who they are now, just look in the mirror. What you were when the world had you and what you are once Christ got a hold of you. That change is only possible through the power of the Holy Ghost and to the praise of His glory. We don't look around and say, look what we've done. We look around and say, look what God has done. Look at the glory of God. You can see glory on every face. You can see glory in the smiles. You know, it's amazing what God does. God transforms people. And if you're not transformed yet, you just need to get renewed in the Holy Ghost. Amen. Because we can lose it. But we're not going to focus on that. Amen. You know what you need to focus on? Getting a renewing in the Holy Ghost. I said getting a renewing in the Holy Ghost. It's the will of God, young, old. It doesn't matter how long you've been in the kingdom of God. You need a renewing in the Holy Ghost. You got to get renewed in your joy, renewed in your love, renewed in your passion, renewed in your fervor, renewed in your commitment, renewed in your desire, renewed in your spirit-led willingness to do whatever God says, renewed in brokenness, renewed in the flow of the anointing of the Holy Ghost in your spirit, man. So powerful. And dear God, do we ever more need renewings? Oh, how many times I've needed a renewing in the Holy Ghost. There's been times where, you know, you come to church, you just kind of, you don't try, but you know, you're just kind of, life is happening. And life happens. It does. Life happens. And you know what? Hope gets deferred and makes your heart sick. Problems come up, things happen, and you lose your focus on the things of the Spirit, and you get distracted by the things that are happening. Life, family, children, maybe a parent or family member dies, and grief hits you, and maybe your job falls through, your car breaks down, or your child rebels, or something happens and it causes discouragement, or maybe something happens in your family and the unity's broken and what you had is lost and you feel so heartbroken. Things can happen and it can drain you until you just kind of don't feel anything. You're just kind of going through the motions. And you walk into church service after service because you've committed to God to be there. And you know there's hope in the house of God. There's peace in the house of God. And you know every time I've come to the house of God and needed something in the past, God gave me what I needed. So out of your, out of your faithfulness, just to simply follow what you know is right. You walked into this house tonight, but I got a word for you. You don't have to walk out the same. You can walk out completely renewed. There were times in my life that it just occurred to me. Maybe I'm slow. I probably am. But it would just occur to me, I need a renewing in the Holy Ghost. Oh, you know what? I'm going to ask God for that. God, would you renew me in the Holy Ghost? I just need a new renewing. I don't know what's going on, but God, I need a renewing. Please, just do something. Renew me. Renew me in the Holy Ghost. And it never fails. It never fails. I don't know why God always answers prayers within a week, but that's kind of what it seems like for me. Just within a short amount of time, he'll catch me off guard, and he'll just knock me down. And he'll pour his love over me, and it's like warm oil being poured over. It's like this refreshing, renewing comes over you, and all of a sudden, your eyes clear up, your vision clears up, the fog disappears, the weight lifts off of you, the heaviness goes, all of life becomes livable again. There's purpose, there's meaning, there's something to do, there's something to live for, there's a reason to life. It's not just about going through the motions. You don't feel like you're losing your mind anymore, but you realize, man, amen, this is what I've been missing. I just needed a good renewing in the Holy Ghost. Anybody ever got that renewing and realized that's what I was looking for? Oh, can we just worship God together right now? If you need a renewing, would you just express it? I want it, God. I need it. I need it. I need it. I need it. I need joy back. I need peace back. I want that life back. I know life has dealt me blows, but I need the Holy Ghost to carry me through. Come on, you can't change life. But you can get a renewing in the Holy Ghost. You can't bring the dead back, but you can get a renewing in the Holy Ghost. Hallelujah. You can't undo offenses, but you can get a renewing in the Holy Ghost. And then you can undo what the enemy has done in you. Oh, let's just love him one more time. Dear God, we're in school. Every high schooler, every child, amen, elementary student, every middle school student needs a renewing in the Holy Ghost. When you walk the halls of your school, you need the Holy Ghost leading and guiding and directing you. Amen. Parents, you need the Holy Ghost to lead your children, your home. Amen. Dad, you need the Holy Ghost to understand, amen, what your children are facing so you can help them have victory. Amen. Come on, we need the Holy Ghost. Somebody pray in the Spirit. Go ahead, talk to God. Give Him glory. Hallelujah. 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 Amen. 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 In whom you trusted, verse 13, after that you heard the word of truth. You heard that word. You put your faith in that word. You heard that gospel, the gospel of your salvation. You heard about the death, the burial, and the resurrection. Amen. And the revelation of a Savior. And it transforms your life because of your faith. In whom also after that you believe, you are sealed with that Holy Spirit of promise. Amen. God sealed the deal when He gave you the Holy Ghost. Woo! He gave you this Holy Ghost. Amen. And He sealed you with the Spirit of promise. Brother Mike, amen. Brother Mike Overby, hallelujah. We've been in Bible study since 2021. Praise God. Amen. That's a long time ago. Amen. But on Sunday, amen, Brother Mike was up here. People were praying. And he kind of was done praying, and I walked up to him, and I said, amen, it ain't finished yet. God's not done. I said, let's pray again. We started praying again. Brother Joe was praying with him. We're praying with Mike, amen, and Mike looked at me, and he said, I got a question. Would it be okay if I just asked him if he would just give me the promise? And I was like, yeah, I think that'd probably be okay. Go ahead, ask him. And it wasn't but just a minute or two later that Mike spoke in. He said, I keep stumbling with my words. I was like, brother, keep stumbling. Just stumble on, man. In fact, stumble some more. Hallelujah. That's the Holy Ghost trying to talk through you. Amen. And in his 50s, God filled him for the first time with the Holy Ghost. With the evidence of speaking a language that he never learned. If it can happen for Mike, it can happen for anybody on earth. It's been 3 years of teaching Bible study, but praise God, he finally got the seal of the promise. Amen. You ask for it, you're going to get it. You ask for it, you're going to get it. Hallelujah. Hallelujah, isn't that a wonderful thing? We all are excited because we know that's a game changer. That right there is when life starts. That right there is when you get that Holy Ghost, boldness, power, spirit, leading, wisdom, prudence, direction, understanding. Woo. Hallelujah. It's the earnest, Paul says in 14, which is the earnest of our inheritance. You know what the earnest is? That's the irrevocable down payment. Here you go. Let me give you a little taste of what's coming with your inheritance. If the Holy Ghost is that good here, think about what the Holy Ghost is going to be over there. Hallelujah. If what the Holy Ghost did in you on this side of glory was amazing, it's $500 compared to your house value when you get on the other side. It's going to be amazing. It's just the earnest of our inheritance until the redemption of the purchased possession. God's making down payments. He's making he's building equity in his church. Hallelujah. Unto the praise of the greater the church becomes, the greater the glory of God becomes. That's why the church needs to grow every day, because the glory of God gets bigger. Amen. And as the Lord lives, the whole earth is going to be filled with his glory. It's the will of God for Calvary to be the biggest church in this city. It's the will of God for Calvary to be the biggest church in this city. Hey, you know why? Because the bigger the church gets, the greater the glory gets. It's not about nickels, noses. It's not about numbers and seats. It's not about attendance, and it's not about fellowships and dinners, and it's not about all of the stuff. Amen. It's about the glory of God filling a city. It's about homes being transformed, marriages being put back together, children getting out of a life of drugs and addiction. It's about a future for your grandchildren. It's about the hope of the world. It's to the praise of His glory. Somebody give God praise. Come on, every soul that gets the Holy Ghost is another praise to the glory of God. Every time somebody comes out of sin, it's another rejoicing in heaven. I would somebody just give God praise because you believe it tonight. I'm closing. It's to the praise of His glory. We are to the praise of His glory. Every person that gets the Holy Ghost, isn't it cool? Six got the Holy Ghost last week. Do you realize I could have said there were six touchdowns by the Browns last week? Big deal. Amen. But when six people got their lives transformed, something leaps inside of us. Glory to God. Somebody got it. When Sherry got the Holy Ghost, we were all rejoicing with you, sis. Amen. Why? Because it's to the praise of the glory of God. We feel it. Why? Because it's inside of us. And we're feeling a witness in the Spirit. Whoa, glory. God filled another one with the Lord. Come on, He's going to do it. It says, and the Lord added to the church daily such as should be saved. They're going to be getting the Holy Ghost in your Bible studies. They're going to be getting the Holy Ghost in the restaurants. They're going to be getting the Holy Ghost in their homes and their living room. They're going to be getting the Holy Ghost all across the city. Why? They're going to be getting the Holy Ghost in the middle of Rose State campus. Why? Because it's to the praise of His glory. They can get the Holy Ghost riding the bus to church. They can get the Holy Ghost on the job site. They can get the Holy Ghost in the doctor's room. Hallelujah. Why? Because as the church grows, His glory gets greater. We need more people in the church. We absolutely need more people in the church. It's essential for the growth of the church and the health of the church that more people are coming in, getting filled with the glory of God. You know why? It's going to lower crime in our city. It's going to improve the school system in our city. It's going to change government in our city. It's going to influence elections in our city. People are going to start voting righteousness. It's going to change business in our city. Because righteousness exalts a nation, but sin's a reproach to any people. I'm telling you, the growth of the church is essential for our future. Noah saved his family because he built a boat and didn't lose anyone in his family. Lot didn't even reach one soul in that city. He lost everything. It's essential that we carry a vision. Everybody needs the Holy Ghost. Everybody needs this glorious inheritance. And that's why when you talk to people, Sister Melissa, I love your faith. It's contagious. Sister Melissa, don't stop being contagious with your faith. Because Paul was contagious with his faith. You know what he said? Hey, you're just getting a down payment. God's got something for you, and then He's got something better for you. God's got greater things for you, and then He's got greater things for you. Everywhere Paul went, he was preaching faith. So he says, amen. Wherefore I also, after I heard of your faith in the Lord Jesus and love unto all the saints, cease not to give thanks for you, making mention of you in my prayers. Are you ready? Are you ready for Paul's prayer? Hallelujah. Let's stand. That the God of our Lord Jesus Christ, the Father of glory, may give unto you the spirit of wisdom and revelation in the knowledge of him. The eyes of your understanding being enlightened, that you may know what is the hope of his calling, what is the riches of his glory, of his inheritance in the saints, and what is the exceeding greatness of his power to us who believe, according to the working of his mighty power, which he wrought in Christ when he raised him from the dead, set him at his own right hand in heavenly places. Church, God has given us his riches, his glory, and his power. It's up to us to spread it as far and as wide. Sister, amen. Praise God. Now we'll go a different direction. I'm telling you, God has more of what you've got. Brother Larry, when you walk into that room, expect the Holy Ghost to show up. When you walk into your school, expect the Holy Ghost to show up. If you're in a public school, I want you to come stand in the middle. Come on, all our public school students. You up here? Where's Elise at? Where's that girl at? She's singing. Come on, Elise. You can sing later. Praise God. We've got Rose State College students. We got public college students. Y'all are all private or homeschool? Man, y'all are blessed. Praise God. Guess what? Y'all got an opportunity to change the world. Hallelujah. Come on, Sister Melissa. It's okay. There's nothing wrong with being where you're at. You know what I learned? God taught me something, Avery. He showed me later in life, after all the school that I went, I was in a private school. He showed me years later. He started showing me how in school, when I was in elementary, how he was directing my life because I had the Holy Ghost. I got the Holy Ghost at 6 years old, and I asked myself, I said, God, I want you to fill me with the Holy Ghost for real, like, because I wasn't sure. I wanted it for real because I had had some experiences that made me wonder and question, and I doubted it, and I got confused, and I got all kind. And God filled me with the Holy Ghost. If you work in the public workplace, I want you to, where it's ungodly, I want y'all to make your way up behind these students. Y'all come up. Amen. And so he showed me situations where people tried to attack me, or where situations happened, or where problems arose, and how he led me and he directed my life, and how the enemy tried to attack me and destroy me through sin, temptations, different things. And he showed me how, through the power of the Holy Ghost, I would not like what somebody was trying to influence me with, and it would cause my desires to be turned away from them towards a different direction. And I'd look back, they tried to befriend me, but it was Satan trying to send somebody to make friends with me to pull me out of the church. I watched that, and I watched how the Holy Ghost made me uncomfortable when there was no reason to be uncomfortable. In the natural, the signs were they want to be friends. But God was saying, you don't need that person in your life. And God was redirected. And through high school, he saved my life, because the Spirit led me through those situations that I didn't even realize the Spirit was leading me through. I had no idea. I had no clue. You still in high school? Y'all, what grade are y'all in? 10th grade. Amen. Y'all are, you already know, there's a lot that happens in high school besides education and academics. Influences. But have you already noticed the Holy Ghost helping you to see that person doesn't have your best interest? They may be acting really friendly, but something's not right. Something's not right with that. I'm telling you, we need the Holy Ghost leading us. And I want us to begin to pray. Amen. I want church, I want us to come. And I want us to find one of these brothers or sisters. And I want us to pray. Sherry, amen. I'm going to tell you, Sherry, what's going to happen. You're walking into your workplace. You are on fire, girl. The Holy Ghost fire. But not everybody's got the Holy Ghost fire. You're going to find out real quick. Don't let wet blankets knock your fire out. Because they don't have your experience. You know what God's doing in your life. Don't let their words influence you. There are situations, Avery, I'm telling you, you're walking onto a campus. Every single day, you're walking onto a campus where the enemy is going to do everything he can to bombard your mind, bombard your spirit. But you know what you do? You just trust God's got you. Every day he's got you. You just walk in the Holy Ghost. When you feel, don't go there today. Don't go there today. Especially if your flesh is trying to get enticed to something. Temptation hits. Boy, resist temptation. Hallelujah. Amen. How many of you need a renewing in the Holy Ghost? Would you just lift your hand? Lift it high. You want to renew it? Lift it high. Come on, let's step up here. I want us to pray over these. We're going to pray. Lift your hands high because we're going to pray for one another right now. We need the leading of the Spirit today. We need a revelation of what's inside of us. God, I'm asking right now that you would reveal to each person in this room that has the Holy Ghost what the Holy Ghost has been doing over the past year to direct their steps, to influence their decisions, to keep them from evil. I pray protection over the mind, protection over the spirit, protection over the heart. I pray protection, all of our, if you're in homeschool, if you're in homeschool, come on up here, I don't care. If you're a homeschooler, you don't have to be in public school, you get up here too. Peer pressure is pushing against you. Y'all come with these school kids. Come on, y'all homeschoolers, come in. Private school, come in. There's influences pushing your mind towards the wrong direction. Come on, resist. In the name of Jesus right now. Lord, I want your blessing.
Until God be the glory forever. Until
Let it be greater than it's ever been.